Good afternoon and welcome to ET Interact. Thank you for taking time off to join this webinar today. The topic for today's webinar is on efficiency transformation R. We all use Microsoft Office every day, but how many of us actually know its real power? Did you know that if you use it smartly, you can enhance your output? I bet you didn't. To uncover its full potential, we have launched the Masters of Time, which is an interesting game for you to realize that the features that you're missing. Today's webinar will help you enlighten yourself with those features and help you to become more efficient and make your time management much better. So joining us today to shed some light on this time management and efficiency is Dr. Nitin Paranjape. He's an acknowledged business efficiency guru and has been chosen by Microsoft's Most Valuable Professionals scheme. He's been recognized for his extensive work on the Microsoft platform. Dr. Paranjape specializes in optimizing unstructured work, which transforms efficiency across organizations worldwide. He has coached over 140,000 professionals in nearly 1,000 organizations with exceptional feedback. He enjoys the status of a business productivity guru. An inspiring coach, Dr. Paranjape uses a proprietary, easy-to-adopt methodology and is highly sought out by diverse audiences that range from CEOs and CXOs to working executives with an IT and B-school students. Over to you, Dr. Paranjape.
Thank you. So welcome all of you. Economic Times told me that we have a very record-breaking audience today, so thank you for joining in. I'm going to switch to my PPT now, and let's proceed further. So as she was telling you, if you don't know, this is the URL where you can actually go and try a quiz. This quiz is actually going to show you 7 questions. You can choose the topic, and then depending on your score, there is a leaderboard, and then some winners will get some prizes. So try it out. Now I'm going to switch off the webcam because I want you to focus on the presentation. And actually, it's not a presentation at all. It's actually a set of demos, and I'm going to do these demos in a very rapid manner. So make sure you pay attention, and I'm sure it is getting recorded, and that recording will be uploaded soon. So we are going to understand what is efficiency, but more importantly, what is inefficiency, because that's something which is never discussed. And then once you understand the root cause, we will see the right approach. So let's go further. At this stage, I just want to quickly do a poll, because there are a large number of people, I think around 500 right now, who are attending this broadcast. And I would like to know your profile. It's best way to do that is to do a quick poll. So just quickly answer the question. I'm going to launch the poll now. I know I should have kept many more categories there, but there's a limitation of the platform which allows only 5 options, unfortunately. So, okay. I'll give it a few seconds for people to respond. All right, so we have people from finance, marketing, sales, HR, but 55% is other. So sorry about not covering your role, but don't worry. Whatever I'm going to show is going to be useful to you irrespective of your role. So it's good enough. All right, so let's move to the next one. Now, what I'm going to do is to show you my screen, and we will go further. Now, one more thing. I'm sure while you are listening to me or watching the demo, you will have a lot of questions in mind. Type those in the chat box, and I will cover as many as possible at the end of the webinar. Of course, we'll give you a link where or an email ID where you can post questions as well if I could not answer them during the session. All right, enough of introduction. Now, what is the problem? I've coached 251,000 people as of now. I actually keep track of the numbers on a daily basis. Of course, those people learn from me, but more importantly, I learned how people use Office, and this is a global thing. It is public sector, private sector, juniors, seniors, doesn't matter. It's a cross-section of people. So what did I learn? And this is very important. Every activity we perform using Office, of course, I should have mentioned Office there, but never mind, is inefficient. Now, you may not like what I just said, but trust me, I'll prove it, and then you take a call. So let's do a demo. I'm going to go and open a simple Excel file. Now, I know many of you are attending, are very senior people, you're experts in your field and experts in Office. So if I ask you a simple question like this, which says, do you really know how to copy a formula? That may even sound offending. Now, one more thing. Ideally, I should, in your toolbar, which comes on the top right, try to make it full screen so you see the demo in its full resolution. Now, of course, you know how to copy a formula. I have put a simple formula here, which says 3% tax. And I want to copy it all the way down. Nothing complicated, nothing even to be discussed. But I don't have a time to interact, but I know one of the three methods which I mentioned you will be using. Some of you will drag the formula, some of you will copy paste it or control D, and some others may double click it. Now, the number of percentage of people who know double click is a little less in the population, so I'll show you what happens. Go to this corner and double click. And now it actually copies the formula all the way down. Those who did not know double click may be very impressed right now, but don't get impressed. What I just showed you is to tell you that never use double click. Why not? Because we hoped that Excel will figure out where is the end point of my data and then copy the formula all the way down. Unfortunately, we never told Excel where is the end. So what does Excel do? It has no choice but to stop when a gap appears in the raw data. And in the process, what will happen? You may or may not check whether it has reached the actual end of the data. And then in the process, you will take this much as the payable tax amount. And not only inefficiency, you will land into a compliance issue. So if not used correctly, Excel can be a very dangerous thing. So what is the correct option? The problem here seems to be we have not informed Excel where exactly is the end point. So before you put a formula, do something and select the entire block of data. Some of you may know the shortcuts. Shift Control End with little bit of tweaking may work and may not work. But no choice, because there are gaps, there is no guaranteed method of selecting the entire range. So what am I doing now? Somehow I have selected the data. And now I want to freeze the selection. So notice where I'm going, Insert tab on top, and say Insert table. Some of you may be using this, but mainly because of aesthetic reasons, because it makes it look nicer without manual formatting, which is okay. But there is a bigger and more important reason for this. What was our problem? If there are gaps, Excel gets confused. So I'm actually creating gaps right in front of you. I will still type exactly the same formula, B4 multiplied by 3%. And notice the only difference from previous to current version is we have a table. Earlier we didn't have a table. Now I'm going to type the formula exactly as I do regularly, and I'm going to press enter like I do usually. Now the job of dragging, copy pasting and double clicking is taken over by Excel. You don't have to do anything, just type the formula, and miraculously Excel will copy it all the way down. You don't even have to check whether it has been copied. I know when I show this in a face-to-face audience, people actually are awestruck, some people clap, some people actually get depressed because they think, had I known this earlier, how much time would I have saved? So that's the problem with Office. You knew one of the three methods. Unfortunately, there was nobody to tell you that all the three methods were inefficient. That's called implicit inefficiency. Now let's take another example. Let's take a Word example. I know there are people from different roles, so let me make sure everyone gets something. So here I have a table, simple Word table. I'm aware that when I speak something, the screen refresh may take a little while, so I'm waiting for that to happen. I have another laptop in front of me, which is an attendee, so I know exactly what you're seeing. Now, What I'm showing you is a table. I'm sure this has happened to you many times. You copy paste from a web page or Excel file and then the table goes out. Obviously, now the job of getting it in is yours, or at least you think that way. Now you are busy trying to get some method running to get that guy in. Again, many methods people use. Some people just drag the borders. Some people go to landscape and try to bring it in and come back to portrait. Some people change the page width. All sorts of weird things people do without realizing one simple thing. Word was created to make human life easier, not more difficult. And whatever methods I just listed, and there are seven more actually, all of which are inefficient because they fall under a simple category which says you seem to be helping Word rather than Word helping you. So that is a simple benchmark of detecting your own inefficiency. I know I'm going to be here for 1 hour, and after that we are probably never going to meet each other. But what I'm trying to show you is you have to start noticing your work pattern, sort of a self audit, and then start noticing these scenarios where you feel like you are helping the product instead of the other way. Now stop there. That means your method is inefficient even if it works. It is working at the cost of your life. Now Microsoft has obviously noticed these problems and they have given a solution. The problem is we never attempted to find the solution because we never even thought that there will be a solution. We thought this is part of life, I have to drag. No, you don't have to drag. So now if you want to find the solution, you have to figure out where to go. All of us know that there are table tools, two options, design and layout. Obviously, this is a layout problem. So I'm going to click on layout and I'm going to give you a few seconds to look at all the menu buttons which probably you have never noticed and think which option may be correct. I know some of you will know the answer, but never mind. Let everyone have a chance to explore. Now remember, it's not that this is the first time you're clicking on layout. Light has fallen on the menu, it has got reflected, it has reached your retina, but it never reached your brain because we thought what I know is enough and what I don't know is useless for me. So now I'm asking you to read all of them and obviously you will figure out the answer even if you didn't know the answer. We are trying to fit the table, so we go to auto fit. And what happens there when you go to auto fit? There are three options. So in this case, don't think too much because earlier there were 40 things to be looked at, so we had to think. Now there are only three. Try all of them. At least one of them will work. So be smart. In this case, the answer is auto fit to window. One click solved your problem. Also notice that I did not select the table. I just clicked inside the table to establish the context. Isn't that nice? Now some of you may be thinking, what is the version in which this is? Is this guy here to sell new version of Office? No, not at all. Now let me also clarify one confusion. When you saw on the opening page, my designation was mentioned as Regional Director Microsoft. That is an honorary designation. I don't work for Microsoft. If you buy Microsoft Office, I don't get paid anything. It basically means Microsoft acknowledges expertise of people who work on their products. So that designation is called Regional Director. That's all. It's not employment. There is no monetary remuneration there. Now, coming back to this, what I'm trying to tell you is this auto fit button has been looking at what you do to fit those tables for 18 years. Unfortunately, that button has no voice of its own to tell you, please don't do this, sir or madam, just click on me. So imagine how frustrated that button would be. So I'm not just showing random demos and tips and tricks. If you search for tips and tricks on a browser, you'll get some 470 million results. Those are useless because nobody goes there. I'm not showing you demos just for the sake of demos and to impress you with these specific features. I'm trying to change your mindset by showing you that what you are ignoring is phenomenally useful. So change the mindset from ignoring to exploring. That mindset is called efficiency. The absolute number of features you know will grow if you explore, but that is not the benchmark. It is about the mindset and the approach towards the product. All right, let's come back. So let's do a quick poll to find out which versions of Office you use, because some demos, of course, I'm going to show you on the new versions of Office. So let me launch that poll. I'll give you a few seconds to... All right, so that's good. It's about 30%, 2007, 10, and 13. And I'm very happy to see 37% people on 2013, which is nice. Nice in the sense you have the latest version, but not necessarily nice in the sense that have you noticed the options which the new version has. So I'm going to go and show you a lot more demos, but let's do it in a more structured manner. So let's start with something in Word. What do we have in Word? Word, basically there are two things. There is content and there is formatting. And you will all agree that content takes the back seat and you end up spending too much time on formatting. So I'm going to show the screen again. So this is a simple Word document. Notice what I've done. I have created headings not by manually formatting them. This is where we spend a lot of time. Not only do we spend time managing the formatting and the color and the font of all headings, larger the document, the number of repetitions you have to do also increases. And then you just waste time. What I have done is, in order to inform Word that this is a heading, I just clicked on heading 1. There is heading 1 for main topics, heading 2 for subtopics, and so on and so forth. Having done that, while creating the document, you identify the heading level, and then Word suddenly starts helping you in a phenomenal way. Now, if you want to navigate across the document, you don't have to do search. I just go to View tab and go to Navigation pane, and I get sort of a table of contents. The formal table of contents would actually be in the beginning of the document, but this opens as a separate window, and what can I do here? This window never gets printed, but what it is showing is the structure of your document. Why is it showing the structure of the document? Because you informed Word about the structure, so it is helping you with that structure. Now, this is not just an easy way to navigate. Right now, I'm in page 1, executive summary. If I wanted to go to results, I would just click on the results, and I don't care how far that was. It happens to be on page 25. I don't care because now Word is helping me. Not only that, suppose I wanted short-term recommendations to come after long-term recommendations, and I've already written lots of pages under both. There's no need to select and copy-paste. I can just drag and drop, and this guy is smart enough to manage the show. Another common problem we face is numbering. If it's a formal document, you want executive summary to be called 1, disclaimer to be called 2, 2.1, 2.2, like that. You don't do that. You just click on one of the headings, make sure your cursor is in the heading, then go to Home tab, and don't go to bullets. Don't go to numbering. Go to this one called multi-level numbering. Maybe you have gone there before, but you came out of it by pressing escape because you didn't understand what heading was. Now that we know headings, choose this one. This is called 1.1 kind of formatting. If you are in legal profession, you may want to use article and section. There are different types and you can of course customize it very, very comprehensively. So I'm choosing the simplest one. And notice what happens. It will actually give numbering across the board. Now, this numbering also gets changed when you dynamically reorder things. Now, one thing I want to show here is about tables. Very often, when you read a document, there may be tables in it. And tabular data is easier to grasp, and paragraphs are verbose and difficult to grasp. So if you really want to quickly recap a document, what happens? It's better to just go table by table. If table looks normal, you don't read the verbosity below it. How do you find the tables? I don't know where the tables are. So now notice Control F also brings you to this particular thing. Now if I open this drop down at the corner, search for more things, that is what it shows you, this drop down. If you open it, notice that there are some very interesting options which allows you to choose graphics, which means diagrams, pictures, charts, tables, equations, comments, and so on and so forth. So I'm going to click on tables. And this finds the first table, which happened to be on page 2. Now you get two more arrows to go to the next table and the previous table. I don't care which pages. I'm just jumping from table to table, next to previous, and maybe manage the document review in a much better manner. Also notice that the headers have become yellow now to indicate tables are there under those headings. If I click on pages, it will also show me pages which have the table. So sometimes you look at the thumbnail of the page, looking at the morphology of the table, you may know, oh, this is the one I want to go to. You can directly jump there. So imagine the amount of effort Microsoft is putting to make our life easier, and contrast that with the amount of effort we are putting to make our own life easier. So that disparity is called inefficiency. All right, let's go further. I have lots to show. I know I'm doing this very fast, but I want coverage more than depth right now, because in a webinar I cannot do a step-by-step kind of thing. Now, all of you must be using track changes, and I want to warn you, track changes can be very dangerous and people can actually cheat you. So this is a vendor which has sent me a proposal. I have called them for negotiation. I look at the document, I change some parameters, I send the document back to them, and then I do track changes. Now the problem is, if I now assume I am the other party changing it, so I say no advance, obviously this will get tracked, all of us know that. I want the SLA to be 99, okay, I want not local support, I want, I don't want remote support, I want local support, whatever changes the other party is doing. Now if the other person is smart and wants to cheat you, they can easily stop tracking changes and then make some change. For example, now that person found out some clause here which says support for 3 years, and they don't want to do that. So what do I want to do? I just want to change it to 3 days, and notice this didn't get tracked. And when you get the document back, obviously you may miss it, and some of you may have burnt your fingers before, so in order not to miss it, you are wasting extra time doing another compare between the original and previous document. That is called inefficiency, because we never thought, Microsoft must have thought of this and given us a solution. So the solution is here. When you track changes, when you enable track changes, you want to make sure the other party cannot disable it. So just enabling is not enough. You go to this tab on the right side, this button called restrict editing. And then what happens? When I say restrict editing, it shows me many options. You choose this option called allow only these type of changes. And from that drop down, you choose track changes, and then you say enforce protection. Now it will ask you for a password. This is a demo, so I'm putting a one character password. Put a much larger password and don't give it to the other party. Now what is the benefit? The track changes button, as you can see here, is not even active now. It is forcibly in track mode. So whatever I do here is tracked, and there is no way for the other party to stop tracking. That is what is going to protect your interest. But wait, if the other party is smarter than you, they can select all, copy paste, put their own track password and send it back to you. So that risk still remains. So what do you have to do? When you get the document back, go to stop protection and make sure your password works. If your password works, that means the other party has not pilfered the document. And this eliminates the need for unnecessary comparison of the previous and next version of the document. Is it nice? I'm sure some of it at least you didn't know. In fact, Microsoft realized that this thing is so far away. Review track changes is here. Restrict editing is very far away. Where is it? It's far away. So this time in 2013, they made it even easier. You see this track changes and you see a drop down there. If you open that drop down, instead of those 9 steps which I did, now you can lock tracking in 1 step. It will directly ask you the password, end of story. So even though people in the world, 1.5 billion people, are not responding to all the potential benefits they have in front of them, Microsoft is still attempting to make our lives easier. So what did we learn from this demo? Think about it. Of course, we learned about track changes and how to protect them. But a bigger thing we learned from this is, when you see a drop down, please, please drop it down, because that drop down has no way of convincing you how useful it is for you. Now, let's go further. So in Excel, I showed you something, but there is something extremely risky in Excel which you must know. When you look at formulas in Excel, what happens? When you look at formulas in Excel, this is a simple piece of data. I have 4 rows of data and simple formulas here. One is average, one is sum, and one is Jan, Feb, March total. Now notice there is a green mark there. That green mark is an indicator that Excel trying to tell you there is something wrong with that formula. It is not there for aesthetic reasons. I am sure you have noticed that green mark, but you have learned to ignore it because it has been there for almost 13 years now. Nobody notices it in an active manner and nobody does anything about it. So minimum you can do is, when you get a file from someone and you see a green mark, send it back saying, I don't want to see green marks, because that means a potential error. In this case, technically speaking, it is not an error, because the formula is only covering Jan, Feb, March, and I want it that way. So in this case, what will I do? I will open this thing, and instead of saying update formula, I will say ignore error. So every error has to be looked at and acted upon. Now notice what happens. Whenever I add more data here, Jan, Feb, March doesn't have any error because I have ignored it, but the average and YTD has gone outdated. That's why there are errors there. So bottom line, when you get an Excel file, first do error checking. How do you do that? You may not remember all the formulas. Multiple people may be handling the formula, so you don't know exactly where the formulas are. Yes, there is trace dependence, but we use it only for auditing and troubleshooting, not for day-to-day work. So what do? You ask Excel to take you to areas where there are formula errors. And how do you do that? You go to Formulas tab and go to Error Checking. And like spell check, Excel will take you to each place one by one and allow you to correct or ignore the issue. Whether to update or ignore is your discretion, because that Excel doesn't understand. That's your strength. What is Excel's strength? Remembering all the dependencies and helping you scan them one by one. So when all of them are done, finally, what happens? You get a message. And what is the message? The message says, finally, your sheet has no errors. Now, this is a very good news, which you have not got for a long time. Unfortunately, this is partially good because this is only covering one sheet. So bottom line, you have to do this for every sheet of every Excel file before you trust anything. Now, having done that, our sheet and file probably is error-free. But how long is it going to go error-free? When I add more data, all the errors are going to come back. I don't want that. So what do I do? Who is good at updating formulas, remembering their dependencies? Not us. Obviously, Excel. So outsource that work to Excel. Outsource work to experts. In this case, Excel. So you select the data and use the same feature which I showed you earlier called Insert Table. And now notice what happens. Whenever I add more data, of course it formats it, that's a minor benefit. When I add more data now, look at what happens to the formulas above. When I just type the data, the table extends, incorporates the data, and automatically updates all formulas. This is how you maintain accuracy. First time you open a file, gain accuracy by removing all errors one by one, no shortcuts there, and then retain that accuracy by inserting table in the raw data. Simple thing, but has tremendous impact. In fact, tables have many other benefits, but I don't have time to show you. If you go to my blog, you can read much more about it. I think I have 7 articles on that alone. So search for Excel tables in my blog. My blog is efficiency365.com. Now, let's go to the next demo. One of the common problems we have is primarily we want to work on data and analyze it. What do I mean by analyze? Analytics is a big topic nowadays, big data is a big topic nowadays, and so on and so forth. So now, analyze. Yes, I want to analyze the data. I get it from somewhere. It could be a CSV, it could be a database, it could be purchased from an entity, data entry done by someone, whatever, multiple sources. But I get the data, and obviously I want to spend all my time and talent on analyzing it. Problem is, I never get it or rarely get it in the format I want. Information is there, but not in the right format. So now I waste time cleaning up the data. So now I'm going to show you this data, and you quickly tell me, think a little, how are you going to clean it up? I'm going to give you a few seconds to do that. So the answer must be text to columns in most cases. Now if you do text to columns, notice what happens. I go to data, text to columns. Obviously the delimiter in this case is a space, so I'm going to choose space as the delimiter. Nothing great there, but the problem is there are uneven spaces. There is only one space here, but there is an extraneous space in between system and admin, in between business and analysis, so it's not going to work the way you want. It's going to misbehave. Is anybody surprised? No, you knew this is going to happen, and you knew this is your job to get it done. And now what are we going to do? We are going to waste our time copying and pasting this together and then dragging this inside. If there are 5 lines, it's okay. But if there are 5,000 lines, you're going to spend hours doing this. Maybe some of you who are attending this webinar are not really people who do this. There may be people who have people down the line who are doing it. But irrespective of that, someone is doing it and we need to stop it. So Microsoft realized that this is a problem. and they found a beautiful solution for it. This only works in 2013. So what do? You just leave alone the original data and just tell Excel an example of what you want. So in this case, I want management in the first column. Just give an example. And then there is a beautiful miraculous button here called flash fill. It is right next to text to column. So people who are struggling with text to column every day, Microsoft thought they will look at it and click on it. Most of them don't. If you do, notice what it does. It doesn't ask you any questions. It just does the job. Simple and effective. No questions asked, does it beautifully. Now same thing I will do for 45 also. Type an example and say flash fill. And of course I can do it for the third column as well. So this is how it's a miraculous feature. It works on many scenarios of data deduplication and various other things. But I strongly suggest if you have 2013, please explore this feature. It's called flash fill. All right, let's go to the next demo. Now let's do something for understanding and visualizing the data quickly. So I have some sample data for us. Just take a moment to understand this data. What is this? This is simple transactional data. This data is showing you transactions done. Every row is a credit card transaction. What is it showing you? The city type, city, amount, card type, gold, silver, type of transaction, date, and some month and year. Simple data. I know there are diverse kind of roles and industries represented here, but I'm sure you can relate to it. Now, if I want to analyze this data, I will typically make a pivot table. So I have a pivot table here which shows gold, platinum, silver breakup, and I have a filter on month. Just to make it visually appealing, I also have a pivot chart here. I'm not going to show you pivot table or pivot chart because I'm assuming you know it. I'm going to show you something new. Then why am I showing pivot table? To show you a limitation there. Right now I am seeing data for across the year, across all months. Now notice if I choose Jan, what happens? Obviously the pie chart changes, the data gets filtered, but if you want to compare the contribution of Jan to the entire year, it is impossible because visually the size of Jan is exactly the same as the size of entire year. So in this situation, to make our life easier, Microsoft created a new method that's called Power View. There's one more thing you cannot easily find out from this pivot table and pivot chart. All of us want to see seasonal variation. So I want to compare Jan with Feb with March and so on for 12 months. How am I going to do that? It's going to be very difficult for me to do because every time I'll have to change the filter, remember the previous pie charts, and it's visually impossible to remember 11 pie charts and do a mental comparison. So what do we do now? New method. Go to data and then go to insert Power View. So go to insert Power View. This only works on Office 2013 Professional. Now when I go there, it adds a new tab. But that tab is not a regular Excel tab. What is it? It's called Power View. It just gives you this much empty space. You'll see it soon. And what does it do? It just gives you an empty area and you can drag drop things from the table, which we just saw. So on the right side, you see all the structure of the table, same data. So now I'm doing this card type and I'm doing amount. Now, unlike pivot table, this itself can be converted to a pie chart. So I have a nice pie chart here. I'm going to visualize this pie chart full screen because there is nothing else I want to visualize. What I really want to do is look at the seasonal variation of it. That is shown by showing it by month. But now in one pie chart, how do I show month? So this is a new feature. I drag the month and drop it into this special area called vertical multiples. And notice what happens. Miraculously, it creates 12 pie charts. Now at a glance I can see the variation. Don't worry about why this is not sorted in alphabetical order. There is a reason behind that and I don't have time to explain it. Go to my blog and say month sorting, search for it. You will find the article, answer, and a sample file. Anyway, so now this is good, but it is visually too overpowering because all the three colors are strong. Let's say I want to only look at platinum, which is this red color. Notice what happens now when I click on any of the red pies. Because Excel understands that I want to focus on the platinum, it subdues the colors of the other pie charts, other pieces of the pie, I mean. So this is how it helps you look at seasonal variation. And I can go on and on here and show you many things, but understand that this is a new method of visualization. Now let's keep it like that. And I'm going to show you one extra thing here and then we'll move to the next demo. So now I'm going to remove the multiple so it becomes a single pie chart. Now I'm going to put month here and amount and make a simple bar chart out of it. So now I can see monthly breakup as well as card type breakup. Nothing great, I could have done it with two pivot tables and two pivot charts. Now I'm going to do exactly what I did earlier with the pivot table. I'm going to click on Jan and see what happens to that particular pie chart. It doesn't show the Jan pie chart the same size as the full year pie chart. It shrinks to show the contribution of Jan to the overall year. And now notice what happens when I click on Feb. Can you see that? It doesn't just change suddenly, which is what happens in filters and pivot charts. It animates itself so that you can see the movement increase or decrease. This animation is not for aesthetic reasons, it's for analytical reasons, so that mind understands movement better than sudden changes. So it's guiding your eyes and brain to understand nuances of whether it increased or decreased. So this is beautiful new way of analyzing data. I'm not saying don't use pivot table, this is an adjunct, not a substitute to pivot table. But as though this was not enough, there is another beautiful way of analyzing data. As you see, there are cities here, so we can now create a map and visualize the data in a geographical manner. And this has always been the paradox or irony of how we do data analytics. When we do planning of our sales, marketing, HR, whatever, it is geography based. When we do monitoring, it is geography based. Incentives are given, people are recruited in geographical base. But when you analyze data, it is analyzed, sorted in ascending or descending order of the city, or on some descending order of amount or some numeric value. So the geography is used in planning but not in analysis. Why was that? Because it was impossible or very difficult to actually visualize the data in a map. Of course, there is GIS software available for years. Nothing new has happened, but that software is costly and everyone doesn't get it. Even if your company has it, it's only going to go to few people who are analysts. So now notice what's happening. It shows me a globe. I can zoom in, zoom out, but right now I'm just going to ask it to plot the cities. So I just click on the city. It has plotted the cities right now. It'll take a while for you to refresh. Now I want to show the names. So I go to map labels and it shows me the names, but as of now it has not plotted the data. So I go to the next step, which is in the bottom corner. And in the next step, I say show me the amount. And now what happens? It actually shows me amounts drawn as bar charts in a 3D kind of thing. I'm just waiting for you to refresh your screen. Now this looks extremely impressive, but this is absolutely useless from analytical point of view because these are 3D diagrams and we are sitting on top. It's like we are flying over India. So this doesn't make sense. So this allows you to change the elevation pitch and then look at it in a more effective manner. So because it's interactive, you can do it exactly the way you want. You can zoom in, zoom out, look at what you're doing. And of course, we can have other things like card type can become a category here. And then it'll color code it and so on and so forth. It can even use your date column, the transactional date column, to replay the data so that you actually see your transaction playing across time. Now I'm attempting to show this play button. You can see the play button here, but I don't think on a webinar platform it'll work nicely. But I will still attempt. Maybe something you will see. Actually, what it is doing is it is going through each transaction row by row and then showing it. You are seeing it, but in a jerky manner. But on without webcast on normal screen, it will be beautiful, smooth. So it's like an action replay of your transactions. And of course, this thing, this green thing you see, is like a scrubber. You can move around. Say you did a promotion here, and just around that you want to scrub and see whether it did have an impact on the intended geography or not. Remember, the data has not changed. So what am I really saying? The data remains the same, but the number of useful things we can garner out of it suddenly explodes. And what is the whole purpose of analytics? To learn every possible useful thing from the past so that we can improve the future. We know that, but in real life, what do we end up doing? We do get data. That data has lots of useful things, but we find out only the statutory useful things because someone is asking for a report. We make those reports, we interpret those reports, and the end of it. We don't go beyond what is requested. So every day on every desktop, a lot of data is lying there without nobody noticing those useful things. And every unnoticed useful thing is a loss of opportunity and a competitive disadvantage. And on the other hand, because this is now possible in Excel, with little amount of training, everyone can use it and then make sense out of the data, and every person or user can contribute to organizational growth beyond standard reporting. So this is a really empowering thing, and I would strongly recommend that you explore this. All right, now let's go further. Let's look at some PowerPoint. I have around, 10 minutes? Now, I'll show you one long PPT. I'm not going to show you the PPT. I'm just showing you the PPT as such. Notice this is a very big PPT I have. It's actually, I never show the whole thing. It's a collection of slides. Many of us have that. It has 201 slides. But look at how this is. I'm right-clicking on this thing called Overview and say Collapse All. And notice what happened now. This still 201 slides, but now I'm not seeing a single slide. I'm seeing sections. Now, how do you do that? That's a very nice and useful thing to manage your long, large, complex presentations. Not only can we just manage by collapsing it, for example, tomorrow I'm going to a customer and they are wanting me to talk about methodology more. I can just move the methodology slides by dragging and dropping, and then I want to show them SharePoint, so I will move that as the third one. So this ability to globally make changes to PowerPoint without struggling with individual slides is a very useful thing. And if you are using 2013, if you go to a slideshow, PowerPoint gives you another beautiful feature called Zoom. If you press plus, 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 let me see if I can show it to you. I don't know whether it will work on this platform. So this is my slide. I'll just wait for you to see the slide. Okay, now I want to show something in zoom manner. I just press the plus key and it zooms in. And plus key can be zoomed three times. So plus, I don't know if you can see it. I have to check on my monitor machine. Yes, this is another plus and another plus. This is good. Now if I press minus, 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 it will go back to the original. But if I press one more minus, what will it do? It will go take you to slide sort of view, sort of thing. So you can jump to a slide. And if there were sections on the left side, it would show you sections. So that is another benefit of sections. It makes your presentation interactive. So at on demand, you can jump to another section if the current one is irrelevant. The second thing I want to show you is smart art. I'm sure all of you or some of you at least know smart art, but there is a problem. When we do smart art, either you say insert smart art or you type something and then say convert to smart art. If you say convert to smart art, it shows you 20 diagrams here. Unfortunately, there is a button called more which nobody clicks on because it's not difficult to click on that button, but our mindset has been ingrained to say more means more trouble. More advanced options, more options, never go there. Now we have to change the mindset. More means more benefits. Why did Microsoft put more? Because there are 145 diagrams and there is no place to show it. That's all. Now, even though there are 145 diagrams, our natural reaction is, no, I don't need so many. That's not the correct way, because even though there are 145 diagrams, it doesn't mean in any situation you can randomly choose any diagram. For a given specific business scenario, there may be only one or two diagrams which fit in, and it's your job to find the best one, because who is going to benefit? Your presentation is going to be more impactful. So with that in mind, I will show you a beautiful diagram which probably you have not noticed. I'm comparing my product with a competing product. I have three benefits, the other guy has only two. Now I go to right click, convert to smart art, more. Now I have to think which category at least it belongs to. So look at the categories. Which one does it belong to? Think a little. Obviously this is a relationship type. Now you have to go to Now, problem is you have never seen this, so you will not be able to choose the right ones. So I'm asking you to take 20 minutes off your busy schedule, click on each diagram. When you click on it, it actually shows you an expanded version of the diagram, and Microsoft has taken the trouble of writing down the business situation in which this diagram will be useful. It doesn't take much time. I'm not asking you to create 145 diagrams. I'm asking you to see 145 diagrams because this is a visual vocabulary. Reading the name called balance doesn't give you the visual picture. So once you have done that, you will be in a position to choose the right diagram in the right place. So I'm just putting this, I'm putting some colors. Now because it's a weighing balance, it makes sense to make it look solid. Otherwise, it looks paper thin. And why is the balance having a weight on either side anyway? So now it looks better. Now the issue is if my competitor adds the product again, what is going to happen? This gets balanced. And then obviously you are going to wake up and add one more feature and then this happens. That's why it is called smart art. It is not just a dumb collection of pictures or shapes or text. Now don't think too much. You cannot add 27 things on either side. Some diagrams have limitations. Some diagrams can accommodate lots of text. So that is what you will learn when you explore the diagrams. So what I suggest is learn the diagrams, take a presentation which you have recently created because the topic is fresh in your mind, relook at all the slides and convert the relevant ones to diagrams and do it obviously for next presentations you create. Initially it may take a little time, but that's a learning process. It's absolutely worth it because the impact is going to be phenomenal. Here I'm going to show you a few diagrams. This is a SWOT kind of diagram and then this is the SWOT which looks like this. This is an existing diagram. You don't have to do anything, right-click, convert. Another one, we often do pest analysis, political, economic, social, technological. Now this is the diagram which fits in there. So just few examples, but I'm sure you'll be able to explore it further and apply it to your context. So coming back, okay, one nice one. Till now it has been very serious, so let me do something little funny. What I'm going to show you is recently, if you remember, there was an incident where a cow or a buffalo, I don't remember, went on an airport and it was almost colliding with some plane, or it did collide, I don't know. I want to show that. So I have two pictures here. One picture shows a plane on the runway and another picture shows a cow. Now I want to combine these two pictures to show the cow in front of the plane. How do I do that? Of course, I can copy from here and paste it here. But this is not going to work because this cow has its own background and I want to remove it. Normally you would have required Photoshop or some similar powerful picture editor to get this done because it's not just a crop thing, it's an irregular shape. Now means since 5 years, Picture Tools has format and the first button there is remove background. And if you click on it, of course PowerPoint doesn't know what is the picture and it doesn't have that intelligence yet. But it is asking you to help PowerPoint figure out what you want. So it gives you a rectangle like this. And then you just decide what is your area of interest and put that rectangle as tightly as possible around what you are interested in. So that's what I'm doing. This may require a little tweaking, but generally it is quite powerful. So I'm tweaking this rectangle to fit the shape of the cow as much as possible. It has missed some things, which is okay. I can say mark areas to keep, which is a button here. And the neck portion which it has missed, I just draw a line. You don't have to draw a shape there, which is impossible with a mouse anyway. And then it figures it out. And then I say keep changes. And then just I arrange the cow. Isn't that nice? Now this can be used to extract one person from a group photo. This can be used for showing your product without the background, showing spare parts without the rest of the machinery. All kinds of different things will come into picture once you know the feature. So first step is to learn the feature. Second step is to learn the application of the feature. Just learning the feature is not enough. You have to find a practical use for it. And very often the practical use may not be obvious. And that is the time we give up saying, oh, this is useless for me. That's not the way. You figure out, think little, apply common sense, and 100% you will find the solution. So I guess we are running out of time. So I'm going to summarize and then take questions. So bottom line is, what are the steps which we have to do? That is what I'm going to show you. So all those demos which I showed you were incidental. The whole purpose is you have to understand that we are inefficient, and that's not a bad news. The fact that almost every action we do using Office is inefficient sounds like a bad news to start with, but it's the best news you have ever heard because now it gives you a chance to improve beyond your imagination, because all the problems which you are facing today and for 20 years already have a solution in front of you. It's just that you never met each other. So step one is to detect inefficiency. Step two is to find the most efficient way. I've already given you some pointers as to how to detect, reputation is bad, when you get a feeling that who is helping whom is means inefficiency. And typically first thought which comes to your mind is inefficient, don't even try it. Second thought has a higher chance. And notice, am I just doing handwork, copy paste, drag, drop, remove blank rows, drag, something like that, and my brain is idle? That means inefficiency. So simple benchmarks. And how do you find the best way? Of course, there is no guaranteed one method, but I've shown you very simple techniques. Look at all the menus. Is that difficult? And think a little about them. Don't try them. Right click gives you a menu which is context sensitive. That means when you right click somewhere, for example here, whatever it shows is guaranteed to be useful in this situation. Now if I right click somewhere else, for example on the menu changed. So it actually assembles what you can do in that location. So right click is very powerful. And of course, any feature which you feel is irritating has to be extremely useful. I don't have time to explain, but just go to my blog and search for irritating feature, and you'll find multiple articles which show absolutely irritating features. And then once you go a little extra, you'll find how brilliant those features are. The whole purpose is to find the benefit behind every feature rather than saying I don't need them. All right, so I just want to do a quick poll because we have another webinar coming up. So I want your feedback. We have thought of few topics here. I want you to tell me which topic interests you. Oops. Okay, I'm giving few seconds for people to respond. We have 504 people. I think that must be really some kind of record. Okay. People are still voting, so I'm just waiting for a little while. And it looks like data analytics is the winner. Fine. All right. So what next? We talked about the webinar already. There is also a Master of Time quiz. I'll show you the link at the end. There is also a work-life section on economic times where we are posting some articles and useful best practices for efficiency. You can follow my blog on efficiency365.com. I write an article every day. That's why it's called 365. I have 556 articles as of now. So read them and subscribe to it if you like it. And then share it with your colleagues, friends, husband, wife, boyfriend, girlfriend, and most importantly, kids. Because nobody taught us office during our college days. That's why we are inefficient. So if we can take care of that root cause, life will be much better. All right. Now, I'm going to sing a song. I feel like singing a song. You know why? Because there are so many buttons sitting there for 25 years, 20 years, 18 years, looking at what junk we do, and they have no voice to express their desperation. So I'm going to sing a song on behalf of those depressed buttons to express their anguish. I don't know how many of you understand Hindi, but I can only sing Hindi songs. And I only understand old songs. But even if you don't understand the song itself, you'll understand the context and the wording. So here it goes. I'm singing on behalf of all these buttons which are really depressed because they want to help you and they have no voice to tell you. Humse aaya na gaya, tumse bulaya na gaya, faasla pyaar mein dono se mitaya na gaya, humse aaya na gaya. So all I'm saying is start exploring and start gaining. And I'm sure every few minutes you spend on every button is going to give you immediate impact and long-term impact. So it is in your interest to actually go and look at those buttons. And when you start liking them, of course, you will reciprocate by singing a song. So what would that song be? Again, there could be thousands of choices, but this comes to my mind right now. Aap yu hi agar humse milte rahe, dekhiye ek din pyar ho jayega. All right, so that's all we have, but I do need to take your feedback. So I'm going to put one more poll and then we'll finish. There you go. And I'm sure there are questions, so I'm just trying to find out, are there any questions? Okay. 65% people find it extremely useful, 34% find it useful. That's the state as of now. All right then, thanks for your patience. It was a pleasure to address such a large audience. I hope I was useful, whatever I showed was useful to you. And most importantly, I know we are never going to meet or interact again, but keep the tempo on, explore, learn, apply, and grow. Thank you.